I say again, amen.
Amen.
As y'all pastor would say, how y'all doing this morning? What about the time it is?
Uh-huh.
Praise the Lord. And after Miss Smith said in a Sunday school lesson, if you profess to be a child of God, then you all have a praise on your mouth. Let's get a praise. You ain't praising for me. You praising for God. You don't owe me nothing. But you do owe God something. You can shortchange me, but you all and I want to shortchange the Lord. Amen. Amen. I ain't going to hold you long like your pastor 49ers played today. Last time he said the saints. But right now we're going to give God the first fruit. Amen.
Amen.
I ain't going to hold you. I'm going to come from Luke. Luke 61 and 62. We all can sometimes use a reminder. Sometimes we have to reach back. Get ourselves together. That's Luke chapter 9. Yes, Luke chapter 9, verse 61 and 62. A while ago, I've got to give you the chapter. Luke chapter 9, verse 61 and 62. It finds, amen. It says, and another also said, Lord, I will follow you. But let me first go bid them farewell, which are at home at my house. 62 says, and Jesus said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Because God is good. And I'd like to use for a subject today, I normally would like to use layaway religion, but we'll just anchor that and say, you layaway, God say you layaway me, but you never got me out. Somebody help me. You layaway me, but you never got me out. And you know a lot of us, and each and every one of us, we know, most of us know about layaway. Come on, somebody. I remember when Walmart was open, where it's still open, I can remember back in the days that layaway had it going on. And we would lay away some things, and you put it on layaway, and you pay on it. And sometimes if you didn't have enough money, Mr. Sister Smith, you end up letting it go back. But see, back then I wanted to have nots. I wouldn't like the haves. You got the haves and the have nots. So the have nots, you got to go to the layaway place. But that's the same way that we are treating God. We are layawaying him. The Bible says that woe is a spirit. And until we open our eyes, we will understand that it has to start with us. The Bible says God is a spirit, and our whole approach to God ought to be spiritual.
Yes.
Verse 61, it says, and another man said, I will follow thee. But let me first go bid farewell with you at home at my house. The Holy Spirit here portraying to us the single-minded purpose which we must be permanent in the life of every believer. That is, if they are to follow Christ as they should, then you shouldn't level him. Luke chapter 9, 61, this passage story tells of a man who wanted to follow Jesus at the future time, but wasn't quite ready at the present time. Are y'all with me? In other words, he wanted to become a Christian after he got older. And you know, that's what a lot of us do. We decide that we want to be a Christian when we get older, but while we are younger, we want to do our thing. I often wonder why we wait till we sometimes try to get all broke down, broke up. Things happen, and God got to show us something in order to wake us up. But he wanted to become a Christian. He wanted to sow a few more wild oaks while he was still young. You might say that he wanted to slowly acquire his religion. He wanted the product which we call salvation. But he wasn't ready to use it right then. So to ensure all of it didn't get away, he tried to put it on a layaway. With the small down payment, he said to Christ, he said, I want to follow you. I definitely want the product which you had offered. But can you hold it for me while I go back home and take care of a few details? He said, yes, I come back and get it out because I know that I need it. Are y'all with me? Don't that sound somewhat like us? He said, once I've taken care of everything, he said, I'll come back and get it out. And I'll follow you wherever you want to go. But just hold up a little bit. With this thought in mind, think about the subject, layaway religion. Think about you layawaying it, but God said, you ain't get me out. I got a praise for you, but you don't want to get me out. You don't want to clap your hands, but you're keeping the help back. You don't want to praise. You stopping your blessing because you're laughing with me. You won't let me go. You won't get me out. I want to do something for you, but you're holding me back. God want to do something for all of us, but we're keeping him on a layaway plan. And then you ought to ask yourself, what kind of religion do I have? It's like I said, if we use Walmart for a chance, Walmart has a plan that allows one to make a small down payment, as I said, plus several addition payments, and they'll hold the product until it's paid in full. Now, there are several advantages here. First, it enables the poor people who don't have a lot of money to enjoy some of the same luxury wealthy people enjoy. Are y'all with me? In other words, it's permission to have nice, like I said, to live like the haves. And it's comfort to those who have bad credit. Come on, somebody. Your credit like mine. Mine ain't all that good, but it's still standing. Amen. When you cannot buy it on an installment plan, you can always put it up on a layaway plan. And if you don't pay it out, you lose your money. Well, you know, when a good thing comes along, some people would try to carry it just a little bit too far. Let's go back and look at this man who came to Christ and tried to put his religions on a layaway plan. In other words, he got him put up but he don't want to get him out. Now, actually, this man was a third person who Christ had dealt with on this occasion. No doubt you are familiar with the other two. The first man came up to Christ in a moment of religious eagerness and enthusiasm and said to him, "Master," how often do we love to call the Lord Master? But sometimes you got to ask yourself, who is your master? Who are you choosing as your master? He said, "I will follow thee wherever thou goest." Well, Christ said to him in so many words, he said, "I admire your enthusiasm. But I think that before you sign your name on the road," come on, somebody, he said, "you should know what you're in for." Because anytime you are following Christ, I want to be the first to tell you, you're going to go through something. I want to be the first to tell you that you just got to pick up your cross and tote it like Jesus. He didn't tell you that it was going to be easy. He didn't tell you that your burden was going to be light. He ain't going to put no too much more on you than you can bear. I was going through something so much on yesterday till phone rang every minute I tried to study, and I just couldn't do nothing because phone rang, and going through something trying to solve a family problem. All I could do is turn it over to Jesus. Jesus went on to say and tell this man, he said, "Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests. But the Son of Man has not anywhere to lay his head." Are y'all with me? In other words, he said, "I'm the leader of this movement. And I don't hold the deeds to a single piece of real estate." He said, "My only earthly possession," Jesus said, "is this garment that I am wearing." Are you with me? He says, so if you look at this and you study this man, it lets me know that Jesus surely put an end to this man's religion. You might say that the words of Jesus threw some cold water on the fire of his religion and put it out real fast. Jesus will, he will put you out if you keep on making up excuses. He won't let you receive what you really want to receive because you got something in your way. Then another man came up to Christ and he expressed a desire to be a disciple. Christ said to the man, he said, "All right, come on and follow me." Well, this man replied, "I'll follow you, but I cannot come now." Now, if they had excuses back then, what make you think you won't have them now? See, they had them back then, and we're doing the same thing back now. That's in the Bible. He said, "I must go back home and bury my father. Then I'll catch up with you in a few days." That's what he was telling Jesus. Don't that sound somewhat like us? Christ said to him, "If you're interested in proclaiming the gospel," he said, "you'll come with me now." In other words, Christ said, "Let the dead bury the dead." In other words, Christ said, "There are enough peoples who are spiritual dead to give the final rites to those who are physical dead." You see, a lot of us, we are walking around physically dead, but we don't have no spiritual in us. A lot of us in spiritual, we are physically alive, but we are spiritual dead on this. But any way that you want to be alive, you must have Christ, and you got to follow Christ in order to be spiritual. Christ said to this man, he said, in so many words, "I know that there are a certain amount of respect that we should have for the dead. Christ said, but you see, undue emotions are just as much as a disrespect. In other words, Christ told this man, he said, mister, you got your priorities mixed up. Come on now. Ain't you ever hear somebody tell somebody you got your priorities mixed up? That same thing Christ was telling him. He said, mister, you got your priorities. He said, saving souls is more important than buried bodies. He said, a revival is more important than a funeral service. He said, proclaiming the chief cornerstone is more important than tombstones. Are y'all going to help me? Somebody said that in all the preaching Jesus ever did, he never preached a funeral. Come on now. And that every funeral he attended, he broke it up and turned it into a family reunion. Somebody help me here. That's one thing about Jesus. You might be sad, you might be down and out, but he would turn your funeral into a family reunion. Next, we look at on the list in our main caravan, our text. No doubt he had seen Jesus performing great miracles. No doubt he had heard Jesus preach profound sermons and illustrate beautiful parables. He was convinced beyond a reasonable doubt that Jesus had just what he needed to gain eternal life. So he came to Jesus and he said, Master, now that go again. He said, Jesus, you got exactly what I need. He said, I need eternal life. And you have the words of salvation. He said, I want generation, and you have a monopoly on it. He said, I want grace, and you have a whole lot of storehouse food. Uh-huh. Come on here. God has a whole storehouse. He said, yeah, I want Christian religion, and you are the only dealer in town who handles such a product. He said, I can't find that at Walmart. Come on, man. No, you can't find that at Walmart. You can't find grace at Walmart. You can't find mercy at Walmart. You can only receive that through God. And he said, Christ, he said to him in so many words, Christ told him, say, you have come to the right place. He said, it's quite true that I am the only dealer who handles the product that you need. So if you want Christian religion, Christ told him it's available right now. And that's the same thing he's telling us. If we want it, it's available, church. Christ told him, say, you are just in time for the journey. He said, come on and follow me. And not only will you follow me, he said, but I fill your heart. I saturate your spirit. He said, I bathe your soul in Christian religion. He said, Christian religion will be yours forever. Are y'all with me? So listen to this man when after Christ just told him what all he would give him. He obeyed. He said that he told him Christian religion would be all over him. He was saturated spirit. After all that, and after all Christ told us, look what this man said. He said, wait a minute, Jesus. He said, wait a minute, you carry me too fast. You know how sometimes we think folks carrying us too fast. We think God is trying to just make us quit everything. But no, God is not saying. He said, Jesus, I didn't say I want it right now. He said, did I? But I just want to put it on a layaway plan. I just want to put $5 down on it. Come on, somebody. He said, so that all of it doesn't get away before I get mine. You see, Jesus, I'm not ready to use it right now. I need to go back home and make my farewell address. He said, I got some gifts in my house. That sounds all like this. You know, if we got some guests at home, we ain't got time for, you know, the religion part right now. He said, I got some guests at my home and we're having a party. He said, I couldn't just take off right now, Jesus, without going back and telling them about my new plans. He said, it wouldn't be downright and inconsiderate for me to leave town with your movement without first going back to tell them old buddies and bid them farewell. So he told Jesus, so could you just accept a small down payment on my religious and put it on layaway until I come back after the party? You see, Jesus, he told Jesus religion would be out of place at one of my parties. You know how we be at a party sometime and we just having a good time. We're talking about everything. But why is it that we don't throw some part of religion in? You know, folks scared to bring up something religious when you at a party or you just out in a crowd and you just talking. The crowd begin to run away and some make an excuse, I got to go because you done brought up Christ. I've had some parties in my house. Brought up Christ and boy, people start disappearing. They said, no, I didn't come here for that. I just come here to get the fish and all that other stuff, the good wine and beer. Come on, somebody. But I didn't come to hear that. If you want to preach, you should do that in church. But we let our way in God. And he told him, he said, it couldn't stay in the same room with me, some of my guests, so I just hold it till I get back. He said, I want it for sure, but right now, sure, I want to ride. He told God, he said, Jesus, he said, I want to ride the old ship of Zion. He said, I also want to cross Chile, Jordan. But just hold my ticket on layaway. Sure, I want to wear a long white robe, but don't bother to take my measurements right now, Jesus, because I still got some parting to do. I'm going to follow you, but don't take my measurement right now. Don't measure my robe when I get to heaven. Not right now. Still got some parting to do. And then he told him, he said, the reason I want you to measure, I might gain a few pounds before I'm ready to get it out of level. He said, yes, I want to sit at the welcome table. I want to feast on that heavenly food. But don't bother bringing me a menu just yet. Just hold everything on that way while I go back and have a little more fun. Now let's see what Jesus and how he handled this man. Are you with me? Jesus told this man of all that he talked about. He said, Mister, you have made yourself ineligible for Christian religion. He said, you have closed up the windows of generations. You have slammed shut the door of grace. In other words, Jesus told him, said, don't you know that anyone who takes hold to the plow of the gospel and then looks back, it's not fit to enter the kingdom of God. Jesus said, don't you know that any soldier who goes forward and look backwards at the same time is not worthy to fight in my army? Come on, somebody. So Jesus told him, you might as well just go back home and stay there since your affections are back there. Come on, that's what he said. He said, you stay back there with them. A man and his affections need to be together. Jesus told him, I don't have a layaway plan for Christian religion. Either you get it now or you don't use it at all. Come with me now or cancel your reservations for eternal life. And that's what he's telling us, church. We either get it now or we can cancel it. But I don't know about you, I choose now. Church, I tell you, this man isn't by himself. He has a whole lot of company today. Each one of these men I talked about, and now it's still talking about it. There's so many people are practicing Lelway religion. They're saying, Master, I follow you. But first, let me go back and throw a few more dice. Come on, somebody. I know I used to shoot dice in my day. I didn't have religion on my mind. Just want to try to win that quarter, that dollar used to be. They are saying, Master, I follow you, but first let me go back and empty a few more half a pints. Because I'm coming down to somebody's room. They say, I'll follow you, but first let me go back and swim a few more customers. Master, I'll follow you, but first let me go back and tell a few more lies. Come on, somebody. All of them may not fit you, but some ought to hit you, because one had hit me already. Come on, somebody. Now, if I could tell them for myself, I'm sure I'm telling them. Say, let me go back and make a few more telephone calls and destroy a few more reputations. You know how somebody call you up and talk about somebody wants to destroy somebody's reputation? It ain't hard to tell a lie. He said, I'll follow you, Jesus, but let me go back and break up a few more homes. Oh, I definitely follow you, Master, but just hold my religion on layaway. Say, I get it out when I'm finished having fun. Well, I don't know about you, but my friends, but I'm kind of afraid of Lelway religion. Sometimes I need my religion at the spur of the moment. Sometimes situations arise which necessitates the presence of Jesus right then and there. And I don't have time to go and get my religion out of Lelway. Sometimes burdens press me down. And sometimes I need somebody, sometimes trouble comes. Sorrows invade my life. And I need somebody when disappointments come.